good to be back almost in home territory. I grew up in Middleburg, which is not too far from here. And my mom still lives in North Shore Towers, which is everybody knows. The building site on the service road of the Grand Central Parkway, even though she's in Florida right now. I'm joined by, I see people from, like Liz Martin from the National Museum, and my friends from Religion Group in New York, Bill Seltzer, Alan Rose, and Richard Sloan. And it's wonderful that you're all here to support this wonderful series, which is huge, I see. I've never worked around a piano before, so seeming. The subject that I was asked to address is Lincoln and Obama. I'm probably going to go a little beyond that. I learned my lesson about Lincoln and Obama in a certain way. As he has emphasized Lincoln less, people are sort of less interested in the direct connections between Obama and Lincoln. I will get to them. But what I thought I would talk about is Lincoln and other leaders, specifically other presidents, and how they have viewed him. And this is sort of a preview of the speech I'm giving on Lincoln's birthday in Springfield, Illinois. I'm the first speaker to go there after yesterday, Barack Obama. He was the speaker last year, and I did make it to my ego a lot of to see a notice in the Springfield papers last week. It said, Holzer to follow Obama as Springfield speaker, tickets easier to get. Now, I've had problems following Obama before, actually. Last year at this time, we were getting ready for the launch of the Lincoln Bicentennial, and we were together under the dome of the U.S. Capitol for a joint session of Congress. Very, very exciting. The night before, and I prepared a speech that I thought would be, you know, I only had 3 minutes. I thought it would be the right thing for me to do, which was to talk about the dome. Under this dome, I said, I was going to say, Lincoln was asked during the Civil War to suspend construction of the dome. The steel would have been better, the iron would have been better directed towards weapons. He was advised. He said, no, the dome must go on. It is a sign that the Union shall fall. But what better message to give the senators and Congress members when they weren't attacking each other for this event? Well, the night before, we were invited to the reopening of Ford's Theater, and President and Mrs. Obama were the surprise guests. He was called up to speak, and he said, about a mile and a half down the road is a dome. So my wife called me and said, you're going to have to do a different speech tomorrow. And I said, no, I won't, because even though, you know, a couple of hundred people here may come tomorrow, maybe 100, there'll be 2,000 people, they won't know about it. And the president won't do the same speech twice, because this is being recorded. Anyway, the next morning we meet in Nancy Pelosi's conference room with the majority leaders, the majority of the both houses, the minority leader. Oh, wait, then we get told we have to go into the hall, told very excited, the president is on the way. We line up outside in her office, and he comes by and meets everybody. It was very exciting, and we all went on. Vast, vast crowd, like 10 times the size of this. And the president is the first speaker. And he says, we're gathered under a dome. So I could have stood up and said, stop that man, but you don't. You don't do that. So instead, I talked about Congressman John Lewis, who was in the audience, and a sort of bridge from the Lincoln era to the civil rights era to today. It went over very well, and I sort of fumbled. I hope I do better today. Much of what I'm going to talk about comes from material that I wrote with a boss of mine, and a cherished one, and a cherished friend, Governor Mario Cuomo. I have to say Governor Mario Cuomo because, with any luck, we'll have another Governor Cuomo soon, but we won't get it. We won't be political. I work for Mario Cuomo. I know Mario Cuomo for more than 30 years, and worked for him from time to time. Whenever I worked for him, he lost. Whenever I didn't work for him, he won. So he told me not to call Andrew for a few years. But I will acknowledge one special person here today, because if it wasn't for her, Mario Cuomo wouldn't be interested in Abraham Lincoln, because she bought him the collected works of Abraham Lincoln for one of his birthdays. So I want you to say hello to his sister, Marie Cuomo Lincoln. I'm going to start with some fairly recent history. 1992, the year of the Republican National Convention in Houston, the year that President George H.W. Bush was renominated president. He was facing a tough time. The economy, like now, was not good. He was about to save home taxes, and we know what happened after that. But the highlight of the Republican Convention was the appearance of Ronald Reagan, the beloved former president, the great communicator, and he got up amidst huge cheering and talked about Abraham Lincoln. He said he wanted to Americans of today to remember guiding principles of Lincoln that were as applicable to now as they were to the 1860s. Here, he said, are the principles of governance that Abraham Lincoln had set down, which remain timeless. You cannot strengthen the weak by weakening the strong. You cannot help the wage earner by pulling down the wage payer. You cannot help the poor by destroying the rich. You cannot help men permanently by doing for them what they could do for themselves. Well, it should have surprised nobody that the convention floor erupted in delirium. The former president had just brilliantly resurrected a tablet almost of commandments, like those commandments, timeless and indisputable. The great emancipator had been channeled by the great communicator in a truly magical convention. Even liberal Democrats had to admit that it was a brilliant, brilliant performance. As it turned out, it was too good to be true, because Lincoln had never uttered a word of what Reagan said. The words turned out to be the work of a rather obscure German-born Brooklyn-ordained minister named William Volker, and they dated back only to 1916, by which time, by the way, Ronald Reagan was himself 5 years old, but it was 50 years after Lincoln's death. He had put together a little book called Lincoln and Private Property. It was a unique format. He had put Lincoln words on the left and his own interpretation in sort of this Ten Commandments style on the right. The ideas in the pamphlet found a very appreciative audience among conservatives in the teens and the 20s, and the booklet went into new editions. But in each iteration, Lincoln sort of vanished and Volker got more and more prominent, until the 1945 edition, the final one, was all Volker, but all of the words were still attributed to Lincoln. By the time Reagan got around to quoting their lines, the true source had really vanished. So a Republican spokesman was asked for an explanation, because Herb Bingham, a New York Times reporter and Lincoln expert, wrote an expose the next day on the front page saying Reagan had made up all these Lincoln catechisms. Well, the Reagan spokesman said that the president had found these himself in a book called, I love this, The Toastmaster's Treasure Chest. And you know, it was hard to be mad at a little bit, because he found it in the Toastmaster's Treasure Chest. But I still think it was very clever that Reagan had left out